Gameday on 740 The Fan and 740thefan.com. Brought to you by Peterman Seeds of Holly and Dakota Bank. Jay will talk all things Bison, Missouri Valley Football Conference, and all of the FCS. Now, your host of Green and Gold Gameday, Jay Bartley.
Well, good morning, Bison Nation and March Madness fans everywhere. Welcome back to my man in the studio. I don't know if I'm the happiest guy in the world, or maybe he's the happiest, but hey, Derek Hansen, welcome back to the show.
Yeah, thank you. Well, trust me, it's good to be back. You know, I always dreamed about, I was telling you off the air, can't wait till I can retire someday if I make it that far, but I do know one thing, learning out this episode, you better have a plan because, man, you can get bored. You know, I always laugh at people who retired. Oh, man, I get bored or whatever. I get it now, especially in the dead of winter, you know. Daytime TV sucks, and so you really kind of need a routine and other things to do, that is for sure. So, yeah, being back here, certainly appreciate this job that I have here at 740 The Fan, and you know, also helping out at KFGO, our sister station. It's just been a great week to be back, and so much going on. I came back at the right time, you know. I guess if you're going to come back, you might as well go in the whirlwind that is sports right now. March Madness has a whole different, you always would kind of have March Madness synonymous with basketball, but there's so many things both on and off the court, field, ice, or whatever that you can talk about. It's nuts.
Well, I think this show, Derek, when I was asked to do it, it was like, I kind of thought we want to show people a little bit behind the curtain, behind the scenes. And what we didn't expect is for you to go through a little health episode. We won't get into too details, but
I don't mind. I've been pretty open book about it, but yeah.
Yeah, I just want to say it's great to have you back. I've known you for 20 years, kind of nibbling on sports. And, you know, you and I are so similar, just being sports junkies. And to have you back and be able to just banter a little bit, a little two-person show. So literally your health is important, but your friendship's important, and welcome back. And there's been a couple times in the last month where I've been dying up here talking for 59 minutes, but it's certainly fun to be back. And like you said, hey, we got some stuff today.
Man, it's amazing. Just now I'm going to ask you as a football fan, you know, we've talked so much about NIL and kids transferring and whatever. We have that whole episode still kind of goes on all the time. And now we got the whole different. You want to talk about transfer portal. The NFL free agency has always been crazy. I don't remember it ever being anything like this in 2024. Do you? I mean, anything like this? I don't remember being
this
nuts.
I was down, and we'll get into the Summit tournament. I was down there, but I was sitting on a deck. It was 75 degrees in Sioux Falls, and I think they... Wow. The free agency, if I'm not mistaken, went live at 10 a.m. And I was just sitting there on the deck, getting ready for the day. Beautiful. Just enjoying being outside, Derek. You know, 0 mile an hour wind. It was gorgeous. It felt like I was in Arizona at the Summit tournament. And all of a sudden, you know, Twitter starts blowing up at 10:01, 10:02, 10:03. And it's like everyone is switching teams, and they were blockbusters. I mean, it was crazy. Obviously, Kirk Cousins, let's talk about it. Let's just start the show. Kirk Cousins, guys, 4-year deal for $200 million. The guy has worked the system better than anyone. And I think I'm a huge fan of Kirk Cousins. I'm also a fan of the Vikings, I think, probably moving on. It's hard to rebuild paying a guy $50 million at any position. I think we're going to go, we'll call it cheap, but a rookie contract at quarterback. But, you know, tell me your thoughts. I mean, he's going... stays in the NFC, goes to the Falcons, where they've got some young talent around him, but they've had no quarterback for 20 years.
Well, they've had Matt Ryan.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
He's okay.
Yeah,
but
right.
I think when you look at a situation like that, if that's what Atlanta wants to do, the Vikings weren't going to match that. You can't do something like that. I mean, my opinion on Kirk Cousins is always going to be big box score, but not much buck for it. I mean, I think he's... he's a fantasy football dream. That's why Paul Charchian loves him on the PA show, because he's a fantasy football guy. I just don't know if he wins a championship. Now, I think it's gonna sting if he wins the Super Bowl with them as much as anything in the world, with the Vikings. We're gonna have a lot of egg on our face if that's the way it works out. I just don't think he has that it factor that we talk so much about. Let's look at the history of Bison quarterbacks. I mean, Brock Jensen was never an NFL quarterback, but he had that it factor, leadership-wise, the championship drive. Kirk Cousins doesn't have that. He's not wired like that. Because if he was, no, I'm not saying that he's a better quarterback. Compare what Kirk Cousins said in his farewell fans to Minnesota compared to what Baker Mayfield said in his press conference the other day. hey, $30 million, that's life-changing money. I'm good. And then we get to bring Mike Evans back, and we get this team, and we're going to bring all these guys back. He's got a little bit of that moxie,
yep,
and I think
he
he's grown up a little bit.
He had to.
But I think so, and I think that's where he's in a nice landing spot, where he's, you know, and because someone asked him about the money that Kirk got compared to him. He goes, hey, all power to him. I'm in a really good situation here. And I just don't know if you can win a championship with Kirk Cousins. If Atlanta proves me wrong, we'll have a lot of anger on their face. Minnesota had to move forward. I mean, and they need a guy who can – I want a quarterback that can run to the chains when it's third and six, run for seven, and get out of bounds. You saw it with Mahomes. Purdy does it. Even, you know, Kevin O'Connell, who doesn't like his guys moving out of the pocket all that much, wants to sit with the system, has to understand that when he won a Super Bowl with Matthew Stafford, that Stafford could still do that. Stafford's one of the toughest quarterbacks that we've seen in a long time. He can do that. Whoever the Vikings go out and get in this draft, because we know what Sam Darnold is, right? You sign a one-year deal. He's the guy to kind of be there to make sure the rookie, if he's ready to go, we'll put the rookie in. If not, we got a qualified guy who's probably been in some bad opportunities and, you know, just bad situations. It starts when you get drafted by the Jets, but he'll be that guy to, you know, and as far as a system quarterback, that's exactly what Kevin O'Connell wants. The question now is, and especially if they trade with the Texans yesterday to get two in the first, who is it that Kevin O'Connell's in love with? Because in my opinion, Kwesi Adofo-Mensah, when it comes to the quarterback, even though he's the GM, this is Ziggy and Mark Wilf saying, okay, you got a quarterback you like? Go get him.
Go get him.
We hired you to do this job.
So what he's referencing is the Vikings making a trade yesterday with the Texans, adding the 23rd pick in the 2024 NFL Draft, which is coming up here in April. So now the Vikings own the 11th and 23rd this year. So what Derek and I are insinuating is that they're going to package 11 and 23 and get into the top five. Basically, the first several teams are desperate for a quarterback, and there's probably four draftable quarterbacks in that tier. So where do we need to get? A lot of people are saying three, but three's Patriots. Patriots need a quarterback. So are they going to give up that spot? The fourth spot, Arizona, desperate for talent. So who knows? But J.J. McCarthy at Michigan is sitting there as that fourth quarterback.
So we think. That's the thing. We don't know what these boards look like for these teams, right? And it might be different with all these teams.
But now, Derek, who has the fifth pick? The Chargers. Who coaches the Chargers? Harbaugh. Harbaugh used to coach at Michigan for JJ, who he said is the best quarterback in the history of Michigan. So does he want him?
Right.
I mean, it's just that's why I actually love the draft, because there's so many like human interest stories, which way teams are going to go. So wild show. I'm excited to have Derek back today at 8:30. We've got Jeff Kolpack on. We had him on a few weeks ago, talking about Bison basketball and Summit Tournament coming up. I want to talk about my thoughts on the Summit Tournament with him, and I think we'll save some of that. I might have a little weird take, and I'm not sure what you guys will think about it, but I'm not a fan of Sioux Falls hosting the Summit Tournament. So there you can just have a little teaser. I'll go on a little Jay Bartley rant here at 8:30 with our man Jeff Kolpack with the Fargo Forum. But I want to keep chatting NFL, Vikings, free agency. Derek, we traded, not necessarily traded, but we chose not to re-sign Danielle Hunter. But we did go out and get a four-year defensive end,
right,
from the Texans, who, from what I gather, is 26 years old, about half the price, and had 12.5 sacks last year at the defensive end spot.
And some of that Brian Flores likes, right?
Yep.
I mean, it kind of looks like there's kind of a three-headed monster. It's almost like we have a co-head coach, because they're saying,
yeah,
I mean, and I have a couple of friends who are Dolphins fan are really not happy about losing that young man, too.
Van Genkel.
Right. So, I mean, as far as what you want to attack the quarterback, that looks pretty good. I'm kind of concerned about, as Jonathan Buller, they need probably a few more defensive tackles, and the depth at cornerback is the other situation, too. But outside of that, you kind of like what they're doing right now.
So we'll talk transfer portal a little bit, but Van Genkel is an interesting one, okay? So I'm a Bison rube, so I follow recruiting way too tight. But years ago, we'll talk like 7-8, Van Genkel was a young man coming out of Iowa, and he was under-recruited. You know, he's always had long hair, and he commits to USD. And, of course, I'm like, I have no idea who this guy is. I have no idea if that was a good get or anything. But I'm telling you, as a freshman, he dominated at USC or USD. So we're down in Vermilion watching this kid. I'm like, how do they get kids like this? You know, did we not want him? How is he overlooked? Well, it didn't shock me when he transfer portaled to Wisconsin and was dominant. And then he became, I believe, a second rounder, if I'm not mistaken, to the Dolphins. And it, just because he's an Iowa kid, went to USD, I've always kind of followed his career. So, again, I'm at the Summit Tournament. I get a phone notification that the Vikings went out and got Van Ginkle for a two-year deal at $20 million, which to me seems pretty value if you look at how 100%. Many dollars were going out. But I like the Van Ginkle. He's just a great pass rusher. If you read anything about him, it always says high work ethic, high motor, gets to the quarterback. I mean, if you're from Iowa, he probably grew up maybe some form of a Vikings fan. At least he's from the Midwest. I love the signing. Plus, like you just said, Brian Flores. You know, they were tied with the Dolphins together. So, again, I like the week the Vikings had. Now, it'll be interesting on this quarterback. Do they make a trade soon, or is this like a draft day trade? Like, someone has to be on the board at the time, and they make the trade right. Like during the 15-minute selection.
Jay, what is your thought on who they're looking at? Because when I'm kind of reading into the leaves and the Josh McCown quarterback coach hiring, I think it might be Drake May. I think it might be the kid out of North Carolina, who I saw a little bit against the Gophers this year. I thought he was okay. I wasn't enamored with him. I think he had a better year last year than he did. I mean, the 2 years ago.
Yeah, he did. His year 2 years ago was better.
Kind of like Caleb Williams in a way.
I think he's a really, really good kid. He's not going to cause any problems. I think he's a great leader, has fine arm strength. I think he's just really, really solid. I'd be fine with that.
Yeah.
You know, we're not going to get the number one overall from USC, Caleb.
No, and I don't think the Bears have any interest in dealing.
I don't
unlike
think
the
so.
Lions and Vikings always trading. I don't think the Bears and Vikings are going to be doing stuff like that. Yeah.
Right. I don't have my names in front of me, but the LSU kid.
Jaden McDaniels is an interesting thing. I just don't know, as a guy who likes to take off, when we saw with Josh Dobbs, when Kevin O'Connell tried to take what was working for him playing sound-like football, Josh Dobbs, we have a bye week, always going to sit and watch film, which was the worst thing you could have done to Josh Dobbs. I mean, trying to make him into Kirk Cousins.
Yeah.
And so I just don't know if he likes quarterbacks that take off.
Well, Jaden is very slender.
Right.
And it works in college where he's just the best athlete out there and running around at LSU with five-star talent all around him, and he can throw a bunch of jump balls. That doesn't necessarily work in the NFL. So
he does throw a nice ball, though. I mean, nice deep ball. I mean, I think that the only thing I think that – he, like a lot of these quarterbacks we've seen, if he gets overcoached, I think it could screw him up. I mean, I think you got to let these athletes be athletes. And Mahomes has proven it.
Yeah, I like the Josh McCown.
Yeah.
I like that hire for the Vikings at quarterback. He's young. Well, he's a little older than our head coach, actually. But, you know, that's a pretty good offensive set. And I think they're going to have to do whatever JJ wants because we got to re-sign him. I mean, we have to have him as the best wide receiver in football indoors in Minneapolis for the next 10 years.
It's going to be interesting, too, with him. I hate when there's smoke, there's fire thing, just like when we're kind of hearing Julie Cousins kind of wants to go back home. These Bayou Bengals that want to reunite with the Ohio Bengals is a little bit interesting. You know, you see when Chase and Burrow and JJ are kind of all talking, that's, you know what I'm getting at? I mean, but he has no leverage. The Vikings have all the leverage. They got the fifth-year option franchise tag, they can hang on to him, and he can't.
But once you franchise tag, it's done.
Well,
you've officially he's playing for you, but you've alienated him.
Sure.
I mean, those guys want long-term security. But I'll tell you this. I've read some of those trade options, and yes, do I want him here forever because I love the guy and I think he plays so hard. But at the same time, if you were to give me, like, T. Huggins a guard and two future first rounders, like
I'd take that.
I would take.
I think
that.
You have to because
T. Huggins.
If that's
is,
what he really wants to do, then you know it's to me it's Marbury and Garnett all over again, right? I mean, you just can't if the player doesn't want to play there anymore, then that's a problem too.
Hey, Derek, we're gonna take our first break. Good, welcome back. Just nice to chat with a guy.
Well, it is, and I mean, there's so much going on, and I don't know how you feel about this weekend. For me, it's always I'm a little bittersweet because the conference tournaments kind of bore me in a way, and the big boy tournaments. I think like the Summit League where it's winner take all.
Winner
I think,
take alls are great.
But the fact that how is the Big Ten going to do this next year? I mean, I watched a lot of the Gophers Michigan State game. You got the home team playing at 11 o'clock in the morning. There's no atmosphere at all. They come out and play like a bunch of dogs. We know that both of these teams aren't going to do anything. To me, I think the conference tournaments would be much better if you qualify, the top eight qualify, and you get in, there's no reason that we need 18 teams in the Big Ten tournament next year. That's going to be absolutely embarrassing. That's
I think
stupid.
In those bigger leagues, you have to play your first-round home game based on the higher seed.
That's a great idea if you're going to do it.
Yep.
And then, see if you qualify.
And then you'll have it down to eight. So, hey, Derek, let's get out of here. Let's take a break, come back, talk some Bison hoops.
Listening to Green and Gold Game Day with Jay Bartley.
That thought he was a stat stuffer, and I understand that. And
yep.
He wasn't great in prime time. he didn't win the big games. He didn't win very many games against 500 or more teams, especially on the road. But there's going to be some hiccups. There's no guarantee when you go with a youngster. I mean, you look at even like the Carson Wentz, the Trey Lance, there's no guarantees when you take that top five pick that they're going to be great. I mean, realistically, it's about 50-50.
Oh, 100%. For every Peyton Manning, there's a Ryan Leaf. For every Tim Couch, there's all these things. It's a very good point. I mean, there's 10 quarterbacks I like in this draft.
Yeah.
And if five of them work out, it'll be a miracle. And that's just kind of how it works.
But I will say the Vikings, they're so set up as far as skill talent goes. I mean, they're loaded. And by the way, we got a new running back.
Yeah. Oh, how about that, too? Did you find that interesting? I know he's a couple years older than Josh Jacobs, but Jacobs had an okay year this year. Aaron Rodgers on the stretch. I'm sorry. They don't win those playoff games. It almost go to the NFC Championship.
Aaron Jones.
I mean, Jones, I mean, to
so
me.
So Aaron Jones was the
Jordan
star
Love was
back.
Because Jordan Love was balanced because of Aaron Jones.
Aaron
and that's
Jones'
why he got
second
better.
Half of the season for the Packers was absolutely tremendous. He ranked first in like five different categories. So excited about that. I know you don't spend your money at the running back position anymore, and I agree with that. Getting him for $7 million, I thought was pretty darn good value. I'm glad we didn't, go out and get a Toby Gerhart in the second round, which was a wasted pick. Those type things I don't like. So don't waste picks on running backs, but it's also nice when your team has a good running back.
Well, you need balance. I mean, these guys are used as pawns on a chessboard more than they ever were. But the Chiefs proved it. They put Pacheco out there as a rookie running back. He did just enough so number 15 could work his magic, right? And that's what it really comes down to. I will say this about Kirk Cousins. I don't think I say this enough. Kirk Cousins, I think, was good and whatever. But you know what my biggest issue with Kirk Cousins was? And because we talk about, did he have the help with defense around him? And we know this, and let's go back to one of the greatest drives in Bison history. You need to have a four-minute offense. Two-minute offense he showed in 2022. He could go back and win a game or whatever. But wouldn't you agree, Jay, a key to the best to close out a game is when you need that third down and four.
Yep.
You can't throw it 2 yards.
Yep.
To keep the punter off the field. That's like a turnover.
Yep.
And Kirk was bad at that. The Giants playoff game was, you got to just throw it.
Yep.
It's fourth down. It's fourth down and 12. You got to throw it 15 yards. And that to me is going to keep him from being a championship quarterback. You have to have that 4 minute offense mentality. Comeback wins that he had in 2022. I mean, that was historic, but we all could see what was going to come maybe at the end. And much like Dak Prescott and Derek Carr and all that, you need to win when it matters to get into that next echelon. Because I think Dak and Kirk are kind of living parallel lives right now, other than they're two different human beings. Dak's in a little bit of trouble legally, it looks like, with some sexual assault type of charges coming up here. But
well, let's get Trey Lance a shot.
Jerry Jones isn't giving up for that reason. I mean, Jerry Jones.
Well, what top five quarterback in the history of the league has only gotten a chance to play four games?
It's amazing.
None.
Isn't it? Yeah, I mean,
You look at the guy the Vikings just picked.
Jaren Hall or?
No, gosh. He just signed it for $10 million 1 year.
Oh, Sam Darnold, yeah.
Sam Darnold's got 10 different chances in the league. He's not great, but he's 30-plus years old and he's still around. And I'm fine if Trey Lance is just a career backup, whatever. I just wish, he went 2-2 in four career starts and then blew his knee out on a wild, rainy day. The wettest game in the history of NFL, he's running to a pylon and blows his knee out. I just would love to see a kid get some chances.
Yeah.
If he's not great, fine. But I'd love to just to know.
Well, that's just it. I mean, I said that to a lot of people, because Paul Allen's kind of laughing up. How do you know that he's going to be any better or worse than any of the 10 quarterbacks we're talking about in the 2024 draft? You just don't know.
He's still the same age as some of these guys.
100%, yeah.
He's 23 years old, and we're drafting guys that are 23.
You know, he was a victim of great draft grade analysis, right?
Yep.
I mean, because he probably should have stayed another year at NDSU because of the whole COVID situation for him, right? I mean, he played one game in the fall of 2020,
yep.
Unfortunately. But when you come out and they're saying, hey, you're going to be a top five pick, how do you not go? You got to go. You're not going to get an opportunity like that again. I mean, the NFL people are telling you you're going to get drafted, and even in the top 10, you got to take the chance and do it.
And the Niners can't, I mean, once they get Purdy, who's, you know, he's unbelievable, apparently. But so then I get that, like, all right, well, that's freaky.
What do you do?
Odd. He's Mr. Irrelevant in the seventh round. And now suddenly you're like, well, he's on a rookie contract, so we'll take him, trade him. So just a weird deal. But hey, Derek, I wanted to chat a little hoops here, but I want to make sure we mention some North Dakota hoops. I actually went out to Bismarck too. I got a daughter who's a senior at Davies. So we've been kind of all in on the Davies train, and Davies went out there with a great women's team and a great boys team. And the women had just an unbelievable, that's the most high school girls basketball I've ever watched. And Carly Franks made 11 threes.
Heavens.
I mean, 11 threes in the semifinal game. She was literally throwing up heat checks and just laughing. It was the most fun game I've watched. A girl just absolutely have a day. And I thought Bismarck was just an unbelievable location. That gym, I mean, it's a little dated and stuff, but it's just perfect for that environment.
100%, yeah.
You know, they actually have two gyms in there. I'd never been in the other one, the smaller one for women, which early round game, kind of felt like you're on a cruise ship to me. Kind of a low ceiling, wide, kind of a like a big ballroom, but they played the girls' first rounds in. But then you get to the semifinals, you get to the big gym, and it's a great environment. And then the state title game, they're playing Bismarck, and so you're obviously in Bismarck, all of Bismarck's there. It was kind of Davies against the world, but Ashton Safransky, you know, she's been the Davies point guard for probably six straight years, mom's coach. She's going to play point guard at Morehead State. She is two steps ahead of everyone on the court mentally.
That's something.
I mean, she's just terrific and just some great girls. So shout out to the Davies girls team. Carly Franks, all-tournament team, broke a state record for boys and girls with threes in a game with 11. Our man Scotty Myshak, I saw in the program, had 10 for the boys at one point, so amazing. But she had 11, and again, just throwing up heat checks that were just going. Anything she threw up went in. It was just tremendous.
Well, that semifinal game against Red River was unbelievable.
Absolutely, I mean,
that was, I mean, going back and forth with
Schiller,
their superstar. That was so much fun. I listened to board hopping that game. It was amazing.
Schiller did the same move 30 straight times, and no one stopped it.
Yeah.
She's going to UND. I think she had 45 in that game. There was a young lady from Minot that got beat with 42. She's got high major ability. Like, offensively, she's arguably unguardable, like a 6'3 guard. I think her interest in defense could probably be discussed here on the air, but we'll let that go. But on the boys' side, Davies again loaded. They lose in the semifinals. And then if you'd have told me North was going to play Cheyenne in the title game in Bismarck like a month ago, I'd have said, well, one of those two teams could probably do it, but both of them are. And both of them have talent.
Unreal.
And North, tons of credit. Like, they got better and better and better throughout the year. And I don't know what it is about Cheyenne, but I think they just play the game the right way. They have some tenacious wings. They really get after you on on-ball defense. And then they had, you know, they had the tournament MVP. Tommy Onneman was absolutely
just stepped
a beast.
Up. Yeah.
When he beat Davies, he had kind of like this kind of roar at, you know, he's just a real silent private kid. And at one point they couldn't get him off the glass. He had 11 offensive rebounds. A very recruitable Tommy Onneman with some Bison great parents at 6'10". He's only a junior. And, you know, his parents are in our tailgate group. And I remember at age like 14, this kid walked in. And, you know, I know his family like really, really well. I actually golfed with his mom at NDSU. She played golf and basketball. And then this kid had size 18 shoes. I'm not exaggerating.
Unreal.
He had size 18s, like uncomfortably large feet. And I'm like, well, how big is this kid going to be? And he's like 6'2", 6'3". And now he's 6'10", and he's all man. So I kind of wonder, like, what he could be, Derek. You know, I mean, is he a high-end athlete? I mean, he pins balls high on the glass. He's dunking. Boy, he really looks good.
I was really impressed with young Mr. Pernu, how he was, you know, running everything too. And boy, oh, the deer kid was unreal too. I mean, that championship
game. See, that's the
game.
Type of kid that wins games. Unreal. You know,
and his big boy cousin that's going to go play for the Gophers could win a championship tonight too. Isn't that something?
It's unbelievable. Yeah. So, nice coaching job too, I thought. I thought by Cheyenne, you know, I saw Sunram out there actually too.
He's big.
He walked through Buffalo Wild Wings. I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, you don't get those bodies.
They're
lake
neighbors. That's all I know. All this, so yeah.
Well, if it doesn't work, I don't blame the Gophers or anyone. I mean, you take that body. Uh-huh. I mean, he's absolutely huge, and I see he's playing basketball now too. So,
playing for the championship tonight. So,
oh, who does Kindred have tonight?
It's a Devil's Lake, so it's the Firebirds and Vikings going at it. So it's going to be an interesting one. So, yeah, it's kind of fun. I know the grandparents pretty well. You can imagine going to watch the AA championship for one grandson one night, and then the next week you maybe go see another one.
Well, Kindred is absolutely loaded. I mean, absolutely loaded. They've got a ninth grader playing point guard that's dunking. I mean, they just have a lot of talent going through there right now.
And before we call Jeff, I'm curious for you, as a Minnesotan who's always enjoyed it, what do you think of the A and Bs, all these – games going on at the same time. It's confusing for me. It drives me crazy, and I'm afraid that you're kind of turning into my state here, where, you know, we got the four class system and they're all at the same time. It's hard to find the games. That is a little concerning for me. I know it's been frustrating for a lot of fans.
There's like a, you know, like a Dateline type channel,
right?
And that was where they're
one of channel six is, you know, point, yeah, one of, yeah, yeah, point whatever six, so. Yeah.
Well, we'll come back. We'll talk to Jeff Kolpack. I've been teasing some Bison hoops and maybe my rant on the Summit tournament. So we'll get some takes and definitely talk Bison with Jeff Kolpack coming back. Hoping
she's not right. You're listening to Green and Gold Game Day with Jay Bartlett.
Not a great Saturday morning here in Fargo. A little St. Patrick's Day run, I believe, in downtown Fargo. Probably a little chilly because I think it's like 35 and blowing about 35.
Wind is awful.
Yeah, it's terrible. We've had some great days. I feel a lot of good football days we've had when we've been doing the show, Derek, but today is not one of them. So stay inside. Watch a million games of hoops because that is absolutely what I'm going to do. I'm kind of a closet Nebraska fan, and they're in the semis of the Big Ten, the first time in forever that Fred Hoiberg's chosen to have a good team. So that's nice for me. But we're going to have Jeff Kolpack, Fargo Forum legend, on, and we're going to talk a little Bison hoops. Jeff, how are you, man?
Hey, good morning, Jay. What's going on in the studio there, which is going to be my home next Saturday. So you got one more day to handle this.
Well, I think we might just trade the microphone. I might be at 8. Are you at 9? Is that what I understand?
I think it's 10 to 11. I think that needs to be confirmed, Derek, right? But
yeah, I was on hiatus for a month. I got to figure out what's going on. And my brain's still in fog, Jeff. So, yeah, but I think you're right because I think we kind of go from you right into Common right after that, correct? So there we go.
Right. Who's Common? Who cares about that guy?
Hey, man, you bleed into each other. If you like golf, you got the best of both worlds here. So.
That's right. No, I shouldn't say that.
Well, Jeff, I kind of teased that I wanted to chat a little bit about the Summit tournament earlier, and we'll get into that a little bit. But we had you on a couple weeks ago talking about Bison hoops. Kind of, I want to go through kind of the state of both programs, your thoughts on the season, thoughts on the Summit tournament. Obviously, record-setting year for Jory Collins and that beautiful basketball team that he's got. Not only an awesome team, but a young team. Losing Heaven Hamlin. Maybe let's start with the women. Your thoughts, Jeff?
Well, yeah, I mean, I thought it was a great season. And you got to remember when Jory took over, in 2019, I mean, program, and again, we beat this to death, but I don't know how you can't really keep mentioning this program without the dreadfulness of it from the prior two decades. It just was a train wreck and seemingly no hope. And it's taken a while, but they're athletically, Jay, finally there. I mean, they're long. They got some athletic ability. They got some players. They need a little more strength, I think, to compete, obviously, at the South Dakota State level. I think South Dakota State, in all three games this year, won the last half of the fourth quarter. And to me, that's a strength issue and hanging in there and being able. And it's also a mental issue, too. I mean, there's tradition. How many games has Bison football won in the fourth quarter? A ton. You know, there's something about that tradition that's hard to beat too. But they're finally getting the players now. You know, hopefully they all come back. I mean, you got to say that in this day and age. But I think all the pieces are there, and maybe a player or two, and some off-season conditioning from. I think they can knock that door down. I mean, South Coast State's going to be good next year, probably better than they were this year. But the Bison have potentially to be much better, or I say better than they were this year. You know, and the season's not over yet, Jay. They're going to get in some tournament here. And I got a little nugget for you here that it's possible if they have a home game next week that a donor will step up and offer free admission.
Ooh, that is a little possible. Nugget.
So,
a little Jeff Kolpack nugget here, Derek, for us on a Saturday morning here. That's interesting.
Repeat that again. What did you just say?
Well, I mean, if they get a home game in the whatever tournament, if they get a home game, I'm saying it's possible. I'm not saying it's a deal, done deal. It's possible that a donor will step up and offer free admission. In other words, pay the guarantee.
Wow.
So,
you know, I kind of pride myself on being like that, the marketing guy. Like, God, what would I do if I could? I think we need like dollar hot dogs, dollar beer night. Just pack the place, make the shack crazy fun, have no seating chart. Just go in and find a chair and make it amazing for these girls because they absolutely deserve it. This has been an amazing year. I want to touch base. This is the first time, Jeff, that our team has made it to the Summit League Championship. I was there in person. We lost 67-54, and 13-point spread kind of doesn't seem like a tight game, but it was with 5-6 minutes left. It was tight, and the crowd is 99.9% Jackrabbits. They all sleep in their own bed. It's corporate driven Sioux Falls money. These aren't a lot of like Brookings people. I mean, some are obviously, Jeff, but that environment is strictly Jackrabbit in the Summit tournament.
Yeah, always has been. And those are the rules, and it's not changing anytime soon. I guarantee it. Summit makes a pretty good check off this tournament. Probably drives most of their budget. I don't know, but the Bison men have gone in there and won. I mean, Western Illinois 8 seed beat the Jackrabbit men 1 year, so it's yep. Not, you know, this impossibility thing. But those are the rules, and you know, you can either cry about it or try to get better.
Well, I'd like to cry about it a little bit personally. Because, I mean, I understand, like, you can't control the crowd, who's in and stuff. But what I do think you can control is the public address announcer seeming like he's got a Jackrabbit shirt on. And I think, you know, when L. Evans has, like, a facial injury for getting smoked and they will not show a replay while she's down for 4 minutes – but yet if we make a foul, they show it over and over and over, and almost like energizing the crowd. It felt exactly like why we win in the playoffs in Bison football in the Fargo Dome, because it's lopsided. But you've earned that in football. You earned the home court advantage. I mean, if the Summit League wants to run that tournament, fine. Run it like it's neutral. And you can't control who's in, who's buying tickets. I'm good with that. But I think there's some things that the Summit League needs to look at that makes it strictly a Jackrabbit invite. The other thing is my group.
Showing replays to get the crowd going, huh?
Yeah.
Maybe they should do that here.
Yeah. We have a billion-dollar board at NDSU, and we don't show replays. But we digress, right? When I started going to the Summit tournament back in the Woodside Winkleman tweet that era, I mean, it was like dollar PBRs. And it was just fun to watch game after game after game and kind of like lounge in a corner in a game that you didn't really care about, but it was just fun to be there. It's changed, Jeff. This is corporate. They do not accept cash in that facility. I know you're working, okay, and I wasn't. They don't accept cash.
Yeah.
And yeah, I whipped out a $20 bill, like, yeah, I'll take this Busch Light. And they're like, well, we don't accept cash. I'm like, where are we?
That is the way of the world now. I think the Fargo Dome was kind of strictly on that now, too, this past weekend.
Well, $10 Busch Lights at the Summit Tournament is not what it started. So, anyway, that's my rant. I'm not a big fan of it. I wish they'd clean it up a little bit. But back to Jory's team. I think they've shrunk the gap. You mentioned athleticism. It didn't look like we were the worst team on the court. They've got a young woman named Paige Meyer who won MVP. Do you know her age or her? Is she graduating?
No, she's a junior. Yeah, she's a junior.
No, that stinks. I was hoping
a Busch Light is $10 at the Premier Center.
It's $9. It's so
$9 for a Busch Light.
You walk in and you go through like you're at Delta, you know, where you kind of weave through like the ropes. So you weave yourself, then you open up a cooler and you grab your own Busch Light. You walk up, and I'm thinking this will be like $4 or $5, right?
Yeah, maybe.
Well, it's $9. And then it gives you three options. Do you want to tip 15, 20, or 25%? And there's a question, how was your service? And I'm like, my service? Like, I grabbed my own beer. So, yeah, it was just...
tip yourself?
Yeah. Can I have 15% back? But, you know, it's just kind of one of those deals. And there's certainly, you know, good pockets of Bison fans there. I literally, during the girls' championship game, I was one of two people. I sat with Brett Winkleman. We sat probably 10 rows up center court. We were the only two people cheering for the Bison on that entire side. We were opposite the bench. But fun, a lot of nice people. Every single person around me said they loved it. They love it. They're from Sioux Falls. They're not from Brookings. They don't go to many games a year, but this is their Super Bowl. They love the Summit Tournament. So, cool.
Well, and here's the thing about, you know, South Dakota State fans, and it's similar to me to Bison fans buying tickets down in Frisco. They buy them in August or whatever.
Yep.
That the team is good. You can almost bank on it spending that weekend as almost a vacation sort of thing, and blocking it off on your calendar, because the odds of the South Dakota State women getting in the final championship game are 90%+. And the men have a pretty good shot too every year. So I just, there's that. I mean, they can plan on it. You know, NDSU fans, especially on the women's side, cannot plan on their team being in the Tuesday game, because it just hasn't happened till this year. So, you know, I think there's that tradition factor that just plays into it too.
Yeah, no question about it. Jeff Kolpack joining us here on the Saturday morning Green and Gold Game Day Show with Jay Bartley, Derek Hansen. Let's chat a little bit. Maybe we should take a break here, Jeff, before we get into the men. But, you know, I think the men had an interesting year. So we'll tease that. And when we'll come back and we'll finish the show, Jeff, can you join us for one more segment?
Absolutely. Yep.
All right. We'll come back with the Green and Gold Game Day Show.
You're listening to Green and Gold Game Day with Jay Bartley, brought to you by...
Like to thank Jeff Kolpack for joining us today in our last segment, kind of a longer segment here till the top of the hour, joining Derek Hansen and I on the Green and Gold Game Day Show. Jeff, we chatted a little bit about the women last segment, kind of maybe pivot a little bit, so to speak, to the men. Just a unique year, roughly, just kind of like that blah team that couldn't get it going, seemed like had talent, at times got a little hot, gave up some big leads late, like at Denver, which would have continued a big winning streak. And I just thought we never really kind of got over the hump, so to speak, on the men this year, Jeff.
Yeah, I just, you know, I go back to Dave's quote after they got eliminated in the first round. I think it was almost direct. He said, I just couldn't wrap my arms around this team, meaning he just really couldn't get a pulse on exactly what he had. I took from that. I don't know if they played well at times, and other times, you know, at the end of the year, they just fell flat. So it's, you know, to finish 15-17, it's from 16-17 a year ago. Now that's two straight years of sub 500. You know, where the women, I think, are pretty stable right now anyway, heading into next year. The men, there's question marks. You know, who's going to be back? Is he going to go get some players in the portal? Got three freshmen coming in I know he likes, but, you know, relying on freshmen might not be the most stable thing to do either. So it remains to be seen what's going to happen here with this team in the next 6 months. I'm curious to see which way the head coach is going to take this.
So the women return a ton of talent, obviously graduating Heaven Hamling, who's been just, you know, kind of that leader, that stud that's really carried the team at times. You know, I think the men who I think at times I feel like have a lot of talent, and then I'm like, are we even good? But I'm going to tell you, the last couple weeks, let's just do a little evaluation, okay? They go down to Vermilion USD, who, by the way, was in the play-in game. So they're a bottom feeder in the Summit, and we lose by 20 on the road when we needed a win. That was a Thursday night. We come back 2 days later at home in a packed gym against South Dakota State. Great crowd. Place is buzzing. It's Saturday night, or excuse me, Saturday afternoon, Jeff, right?
Yep.
And we get our doors blown off. Right? I mean, just flat, no energy, and I'm like, okay.
Right off the bat, right.
Off the bat. And they're doing chin-ups on the rim against us in our gym. And so all year, Jeff, it was just go to the Summit tournament, win three games. And all year, everyone said, hey, anyone can win. And they were right, because there was a lot of upsets in the Summit League championship. I mean, what a fortunate run the Jackrabbits had to basically play nobody. But I thought, okay, that's fair. All right, we lose at USD terribly. We come home, get dominated at home by the Jacks. All right, hey, all we need is three wins in Sioux Falls. And we go down there, and we're down 20 in the first half to an average St. Thomas team.
Yep. Boy, you took it. I don't know what else to say other than just was discombobulated there at the end. You know, I thought the sophomore class, last year's freshmen, I didn't see the strides I wanted to see in these guys. I didn't think they took that next level. You know, I thought, you know, like Tejavis and Damari and you know, it just didn't take that extra step this year for whatever reason. And I don't know why.
I agree. I thought if you look at development, I thought Andrew Morgan had about a month where I thought he had made some strides.
Yeah,
he had made some step-out three-pointers. He became the man. I thought the last 5 minutes against UND – where it was just like, hey, get out of his way, pound it, he's going to the free throw line. I think that's a kid that really showed some development. But we, you know, I wanted to chat a little bit about, you know, how do we solve it, right? And we're in this, you know, the world, I'm helping run the Green and Gold Collective. We've got NIL opportunities. Kids have choices. And I see Joshua Streit has already chosen to leave the program through the transfer portal. Bowden Skunberg has entered the transfer portal. I'll say, I guess that's no surprise. I mean, he went through senior day at home against South Dakota State.
He was gone, yep.
But, you know, here's the problem I had is I'm down there in person in Sioux Falls, and we're down 20 at half, and I'm like, who is going to lose their mind on the bench? I want to see a player, like, really get after someone and really compete. The first 5 minutes of the second half, we dominated. I believe it was a 12-0 run, and suddenly we're in the game. But I'm watching body language. I still didn't see anyone on that team that was losing it. Like, let's go. Like, I want to see some fire, and I just didn't see it. So I'm going to say this. I hope we bring some changes. I'm not talking coaching changes. I'm not talking anything like that. I'm talking fire. I want to get some guys that have some fire. I don't care if we attack the JUCO. I think our coaching staff is got some JUCO ties. So I'm excited about some different opportunities. We've got NIL opportunities. We've got NIL money through the collective to see what we've got. This is a proud program, and I think a fan base that wants it. I think the fan base showed it this year for the women. Like, if you put a product on the court, you know, it's exciting. So I think, Jeff, what we need to do is kind of get back to who we are, and Dave's not going to change how he coaches, the passion, the fire, but we need to get some fire in the bellies of those teams. I mean, in the Woodside era, everyone looked at Woodside. He had the fire. So if there was a timeout, you're like, all right, follow Woody. This team didn't have that guy. And Andrew Morgan's the leader on the court, but it's not a fiery personality. He's a fairly quiet kid, and there's nothing wrong with that. But I think we got to have some fire on that squad.
Well, I would go like guys like Vinny and Shahid too, you know, just that point guard off front who was just commanded presence. Woody is a great example. Lawrence Alexander, Marshall Bjorklund.
Taylor Brown.
Yeah, Taylor Brown, that's a great example.
Taylor Brown is one of my all-time favorites, and he was, you know, he had edge. I mean, he had an edge. Yeah. He'd get in a fight at UND. He had just, you know, get on my back, you know, we got a big game tonight type attitude, so... I'm hoping Dave can find that.
Yeah, and they always preach up at the you know, it's kind of the big thing now. We're a player driven program, you know, and I think that was a Chris Kleiman started that, and everybody else has kind of hopped on board on on we're a player driven program. Well, yeah, I don't know if I saw that this year. I just sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. And if you don't have the right mix of personalities, I thought the Bison women had it. I mean, obviously, Heaven Hamling was the player, and yep. Everybody, she was the glue there. And they only had 10 players. I think in a perfect world, if you could guarantee nobody got hurt,
yeah,
you'd have a 10-player roster. You don't need more than that. You know, anybody, players 11, 12, 13 aren't going to play. Are they on board with you? Are they in the boat, so to speak? You know, with 10 players, everybody has, with the women, everybody had a role. Everybody played. You knew you're going into the game. There was nobody at the end of the bench. You know,
I think that's interesting. You talk about those 10 players. When Jory does a huddle, the five players that are playing sit on the bench, like in order, so to speak, and then the backups stand behind them. And it's almost like Jory's the quarterback in an NFL huddle.
Yeah.
Where he's got his like lineman kind of standing. He's got his skill position players, you know, in front of the line. But man, are they into it? And it's fun to watch those girls pat each other on the back. And those 10 girls were unified down this stretch run after they lost three to the portal over I believe the holidays, I think, is when those three left, Jeff.
Right. Yeah. And 10 players, if you're the 10th player, so to speak, I mean, you may be in that next 3 seconds. I mean, so you better be paying attention. And I think that makes a difference. Smaller rosters are more engaged, and you don't have, again, you don't have that potential of a sulking player at the end of the bench, just, you know, not having a great attitude. I don't know if players in this day and age want to wait 2 to 3 years before they see the lineup anymore. If you're down on the depth chart, if you're player 12 on a basketball roster, I don't know how engaged they are anymore. Maybe you can find a kid that's, hey, I'm gonna stick it out. I'm going to work my hardest I can in the next 2-3 years. Hopefully I'll see the lineup by the time I'm a junior. I don't know, in this day and age with AAU basketball and parents investing so much in travel for these kids growing up, that they're willing to have the attitude that, you know what, I'm going to hang around. I'm going to get better. I'm going to prove that I'm a Division I player, and I'll do what it takes, and I'll have the greatest attitude for 2 years, even though I'll hardly play. I don't know if that exists anymore. I really don't.
Yeah, I think the career backup routine, you know, being the 11th guy on a bench for 4 to 5 years is not probably what
not a thing.
Yes, it's not right. Really a thing. And I think when you're being recruited, you're going to go there to play. And I don't mind kids having options. And certainly this is the transfer portal day and age with collectives and NILs. There's just a lot of different opportunities for people. So it'll be interesting. But, Jeff, you wrote an article this week about the three-class system in North Dakota High School. Your mind has kind of changed, I guess, a little bit over time. Just tell us a little bit about your thoughts there.
Well, I was against it. I think when you have the cream of the crop high school event in the state, which was the B, I mean, that was the cash cow. That was just such a great event. And to split it up, I don't know if that was the wisest thing to do. But, you know, but again, that's old school Jeff talking. I mean, that's Jeff who saw Edgley win in 1990 unexpectedly, or you know, some of these teams in these tournaments. And I don't know if the thing about the BJ is, if you live anywhere in small town North Dakota, a lot of fans just go to they went to the B anyway, no matter what. I mean, just because their team wasn't in it, they'd go. I don't know if the fan in Edgley, North Dakota now, who used to go to the B all the time, where do you go now? Maybe they go to the small. Maybe they are going to Minot this weekend. I don't know. I guess we'll find out on attendance. But I just to split it up for the sake of, because the normal, you know, there's too many teams that were in it every year, the usual kindreds of the world. I don't know. Milner won it in what, 2015. Milner isn't very big. I mean, so. But now that it's here again, I'm no use griping about it. That was my column. It's here. Let's support it. Let's you know, make it the best event and experience for these kids as possible.
Well, Derek and I were just saying, because it's new, it's just it's confusing. It's, you know, you're a little bit lost on who's playing where and when.
Welcome to Minnesota, folks. This is what you got. I warned you all. I mean, I've been on a rant. You know, I think that you could mix up you could have three divisions, but mix up the A's in a tournament with eight teams, because. Nothing against the Cheyenne kids. I'm happy what they did. It's so weird to me on the side of the river I live in, you lose a regional semifinal game, then you win the whole state championship. It's just, I mean, it's just, I think if Kindred versus Cheyenne, you know, watching those cousins play each other, that'd be an interesting David versus Goliath thing, you know, to see something like that. And it,
oh, I don't think Kindred would be that much of a David. I mean,
but that's what I'm saying. Good. That's my whole point, the separation. We have less of a pool of schools. I mean, you mentioned Milner. Well, that whole county's one school now. There used to be three just a few years ago. The pool isn't as big anymore. You don't need to have the same eight teams come back after the region tournament, go in the state tournament, double A. It would help out the double A too. It's just, it's too much. And I've warned these people, but here you are. So congratulations. You get all this all at one time, and now it's going to get lost in the shuffle, and it's ticking people. I feel sorry for your friends at Channel 6 trying to explain. I mean, that grid they put up, that makes no sense at all, and you can't find it anywhere. I you know, they got a bad deal bargaining for that, knowing that they have to have grandmas trying to find their grandsons on a streaming service. It's so
true crime network.
Yeah, it's a bad deal.
Well,
it's hard. Yeah, there's no doubt. And we got to do better as a. I mean, I don't know how you explain. Okay, this is, you know, streaming. This is WDY.
You can't.
To some people, I mean, you got to know your platforms. You got to know your streaming. You got to know your television system. I mean, it's simple as that. A lot of people don't.
Well, Jeff, we had you on about a month ago talking about basketball and the Summit League tournament that was coming up. So we wanted to have a little summary of our hoop season. So thank you very much for coming on. And I'd like to thank our fans for supporting the Bison Nation and the hoops. We've got one more month of the show, and we're going to be chasing the hoops hoop dreams around March Madness. So this Sunday, which will be tomorrow, the brackets come out, Derek, which is kind of a national holiday in my household, get the brackets. And then next Thursday, a national holiday when the big tournament, the big dance starts. So thank you, Bison Nation, for listening. We will be back next Saturday talking about March Madness. Have a great week.
You've been listening to Green and Gold Game Day with Jay Bartley on 740 The Fan and 740thefan.com. Brought to you by Peterman Seeds of Holly and Dakota Bank.